Hey, good morning. It's Dr. Shirley. How are you today? We are talking all things health and digestion today. It's nice to have you with us. I'm here in upstate New York, and I am here to spread the word of getting well naturally. What that means, you know, that means changing our lifestyle a little bit at a time. Maybe it means, you know, clearing out some of the crap from our cupboards. Maybe it means starting to, you know, to meditate. Maybe it means starting a new exercise program or being calmer or, you know, really just doing some self-care. All of those things go into getting well naturally. I was speaking to someone yesterday who is, one of my students, and she was, let's just say she wanted to spend some time with some friends, and I said, you know what, spending time with girlfriends is a big part of getting well naturally, isn't it? So we need all of this support. So welcome, and today we're going to be talking about digestion. My background is I'm a doctor of naturopathy, so I'm not a medical doctor. I'm not here to diagnose. I'm not here to prescribe. We don't do that. But what we do is to find out what is a causative factor of what's going on. So good morning. How are you, Liz? Nice to see you, Rick. Hey, Meg. Nice to see you. So we're always trying to find what is the causative factor, okay? And what that means is that sometimes just because we have a symptom, that doesn't mean that just quelling that symptom is going to make a difference. And I'll give you an example that's, you really hit very hard to home for me. When my daughter, Mackenzie, was very young, and she was 13 years old, and she was a cheerleader, and she was one of those girls that flew. And so, you know, she was a flyer, and she fell on her head. There's a cheerleading accident, if you will, and her skull, got split. She ended up, needing emergency brain surgery. But prior to that, it was around midnight, and she started to vomit. And, she was vomiting. And so the nurse comes in, she says, well, I have some anti-vomit medication. I'm like, no. That, a 13-year-old kid just doesn't vomit profusely at midnight when there's not a problem going on. And so we ended up, it's a long story that I won't share all of you, but we ended up, the doctor, surgeon needed to get in there. So the point was, she was vomiting because she was having a brain bleed, okay? So she didn't need anti-nausea medication. She needed a surgeon. So that was just one small symptom of what can go on. So I'm always trying to find out what is the causative factor, and let's correct that at the source. And that's what natural medicine is. A lot of your regular meds are going to cause side effects. I remember my dad was on high blood pressure medication. That caused him to urinate more. And so then there was a urination medication, and that made him tired. And then he needed something else for energy. And it just went on and on and on. Our body has the ability to be strong. And let's talk about digestion, because when we digest our food, it has absolutely everything to do with how we're going to feel on a regular basis, right? If you've got a bellyache, you're not going to be feeling well. So let's talk a little bit about, the physiology. Does anyone know where digestion starts? Anywhere along the lines, okay? Most people think digestion starts, in our gut, but it actually starts with aroma. Do you ever walk through the mall and you smell like that Auntie Annie's pretzels, or you come, there's baking bread or cookies in the oven? This starts our saliva juices coming out of our mouth, which is really where the digestion starts, okay? So that's the first part. Hey, Casey. Hey, Jeff. Nice to see you, Bryce. So that's really where it starts. And then from there, when these enzymes get secreted, they start to break our food down. Now, just eating food and having food in our mouth, okay? If you just took a piece of bread and you pounded it with your fist, it isn't going to break down, is it? But when it's in your mouth and these enzymes are starting to be secreted, then it starts to break down. So that's where the digestion process happens. There is a lot to that whole thing. We'll chew your food 20, 30 times. It's hard to think about, but if you do chew slower, those enzymes are going to chance to break that food down. It's going to go down, through the esophagus and have a much easier path all the way through. So chewing your food, again, you're going to have your amylase out there, and that starts to break down your carbohydrates, and your simple sugars start to break down right away as well too. So the aroma is the first thing. Next thing we go, into our mouth, and then we start to go down to the esophagus. The esophagus is basically just a transporter. It is a tube. It transports your food, from your mouth, right into your stomach, okay? So it's a very important transporter there. And if you hear of people saying, oh, if they have a, esophageal cancer, that normally is down on the lower part, and that's when there's acid in the stomach that has gone up, and it helps to, kind of eat away at some of the protective linings that are there. So other than that, you don't hear too much about the esophagus, but again, it really just is a transporter to get everything everything down there. Now, when you get to your stomach is primarily responsible for digesting your food. There's been a lot of challenges lately with people, with wheat, right? I had some difficulty last year, just out of the blue had difficulty digesting breads and sugars, from nowhere. And what it was is I ended up finding out that I had some leaky gut going on, which so many of us have because of all the crap that's in the food. We'll talk about that in another class. But as we get into the stomach, that's where all of our food gets absorbed. We need to have enzymes present in order to break down the food. Over the age of 45, somewhere right around there, our food just doesn't break down, okay? And that's where we start to get a bellyache. And you think like, oh, I can't have tomatoes. They don't digest well, or I'm allergic, to this or that. You're probably not. It's probably just that you can't break the food down. Hey, Jim, nice to see you. And if the food doesn't break down, then it's going to start, with gassing. You're just going to have bloating. And again, then you're going to think you can't eat this food. So think about some of the different enzymes. And, there's a lot of enzyme supplements that you can get. And again, if you're over the age of 45, you're not digesting well, I would start as a first course of action of getting a very good enzyme supplement. If you want to know something specific, just, give me a message. I'll be happy to help you. Even something as simple as papaya. Okay. Papaya enzyme is a great enzyme that helps your food to digest. In fact, it's in one of my nighttime. I take a skeletal strength calcium magnesium that has papaya in because it helps to break it down. The next enzyme is protease. It's protease. Pro meaning protein. So protease helps to break down your protein. So this is obviously, your eggs, your meats and all that, but also things like parasites, right? We talked about parasites before, and the protease helps to break them down because they are of a protein nature. So it's very important we have these enzymes. I talked a little bit yesterday about the digestive process, I think, in water. So we do not want to have any water with our meals. You don't want to have Coke with your meals. You don't want to have coffee with your meals. Yes, maybe sip. I got a little bit here. Maybe sip a little bit, but what happens is if you drink water with your meals, it dilutes all of your enzyme and your food is not going to digest as well. So you want to have your water on an empty stomach in between your meals, and in a little bit towards a warmer side is going to be a little bit better for you. So we also have our amylase, and amylase is another enzyme, and amylase helps to break down our carbohydrates. A lot of times we're having more difficulty breaking down carbs because of the way the GMOs have a lot to do with it. You can do some reading on that, and what's going to happen is that when we take in some of these GMOs, there's a whole different enzymatic and function that happens within the body, and we're going to start having reactions overall. Thanks, Casey. Yeah, I appreciate that. Casey's an expert herself in aromatherapy. She teaches me a lot as well too. So inside our digestive system, we also have what's called hydrochloric acid. Now, sometimes you may think the word, my body's too acidy. You need acid, okay? Hydrochloric acid, or HCA, helps to break down your foods. Hydrochloric acid is so strong that it could break down a hunk of concrete, believe it or not. So when we don't have, now under the age of 5, we don't really have our hydrochloric acid digested, and that's why those in that age group are very prone to parasites and can have a lifetime of difficulty. And then those over the age of 45 to 50, also our hydrochloric acid starts to go down bit by bit by bit. So we're not having as much of this. You can get hydrochloric acid in a supplement and with your enzymes to help your food digest. When the food digests better, we're going to get the nutrients out of it, we're going to get the value, and it's going to help to feed the rest of our body. So that's why the stomach is so, so important. This digestive system is really, so important. It does increase, as I said, but decrease in age. Over the age of 60, we have lost over 50% of our hydrochloric acid. So it's no wonder as we get older, we say, oh, I can't eat this. You should be able to eat everything, okay? I mean, unless you got some kind of seafood allergy or peanut allergy. I get that. But, other than that, you should be able to digest any foods. Now, I'm talking about that before I move on. There are certain foods that digest in different ways. So your fruits are going to digest very quickly. Your fruits are digest in about 20 minutes, okay? Fruits are best eaten on an empty stomach. They are not best eaten at the end of a meal. And I'm going to give you a little bit of an analogy about that. Our carbohydrates take about You know, simple carbohydrates, maybe from 20 to 40 minutes, or complex carbohydrates, 1 to 2 hours. Then when you get into your proteins, like a hunk of beef, I mean, this is a muscle from an animal, okay? Let's face it, if you're eating, you know, animal meat, it can take days and days for that to break down within your system. So you can have this whole kind of toxic soup going on if your digestive system isn't working, you know, real well. I like to, you know, think of it along the lines of, like, you know, let's say, you know, you're going to a picnic, okay? And there's barbecue chicken going on, and there's some watermelon underneath here, and you've got some macaroni salad, there's some potato salad. It's a typical American, you know, barbecue going on. So what do? We get our chicken, so we put the chicken in first. And keep in mind, this is like a tube, okay? We got our body here. We put in the chicken, and this chicken's going to take a couple days to digest. You put in your macaroni on top of that, maybe you put in some green salad. That's going to start digesting in 40 minutes. And then what do? Why do we serve fruit for dessert? I mean, I have no idea. You should never have fruit for dessert. You have your fruit first. So you think about this tube, okay? Got the protein in there. Then you've got your carbs on top of that. Then you're going to have some salad. Then on top of that, you're going to finish off with some fruit. Now the fruit starts digesting, like I said, in about 20 minutes. What's going to happen? It can't get through. Can't get through the carbs, can't get through the rest of it. And all of a sudden, you got bloating, gas, indigestion, and you think you can't eat fruit, okay? Not the case. Eat your fruit first, okay? I remember going to many barbecues and, you know, in family picnics, and, you know, I'd have my kids, they'd be lifting up the foil, you know, and taking out that. And I remember once, you know, I think it was my former mother-in-law, was just kind of chasing, like, hey, that's for dessert. Don't be eating that now. Well, we went ahead and ate it now. So make sure that you do that. Let's talk about the small intestine a little bit. The small intestine is amazing, and that's where so much of your mineral absorption goes on. When people have what's called a spastic colon, that usually is going on in the small intestine, and that can be very uncomfortable. And most of the time, the spastic colon is caused from stress, okay? Our bodies can get stressed, our heart can get stressed, we can get stressed, but if our internal organs get stressed, they start to cramp and they start to cause, you know, difficulties. Again, this does not have anything to do with the type of food you're eating. It has to do with the peristalsis, which is the movement, okay, around our organs. It's almost like, you know how a worm has all those like girdles around it, you know, and it kind of inches, or a snake, right? It moves its way along. That's how peristalsis works. And that's how our food, you know, travels through our whole system. So if we're holding a lot of stress, we don't have a lot of magnesium, we can have this belly that really starts to hurt. And that's usually more so, not as much the stomach, but usually more so on the small intestine. So with that, you know, you're going to find that all of your digestive secretions are going to start to happen there. We get excretions from the liver and the pancreas there. All of these play a part in the digestive process, and they all kind of latch into this small intestine. Small intestine is about 21 feet long. And one of the reasons, you ever see like little kids are so cute, right? The 2 and 3 year olds, and they got those big bellies. It's, you know, right? They got these big bellies sticking out. And what that is that their intestines are too big for their little bodies. And that's why around the age of 3 or 4, they start to slim down and they get smaller. So the babies are born with big digestive systems and they almost have to literally grow into them. So 3 segments in the small intestine. The first is the duodenum. You may not need to know all this, but maybe it's good for a conversation someday. Your duodenum is in, you know, the first, you know, say 10 to 12 inches or so. And that's really where all your minerals are going to start to get absorbed. So there's a real beautiful natural thing that happens. The next part is called the jejunum, and that goes on for quite a bit more, about 8 feet long. And in our jejunum is where we're going to start to do our vitamins, our carbohydrates. All of those will get absorbed at that particular point. So you picture the food coming in, into the mouth, down the esophagus, into the stomach, and then into the small intestine. And then that's where our body starts to grab out all the minerals and all the good food. It's also where, you know, all the toxins, you know, start to go too. Now, the last portion is called the ileum. You may have heard of like ileocecal valve. So that's the ileum, you know, that goes on there. And that's where your fats are going to be absorbed. Cholesterol, which is a good thing, if you remember, you know, from last time. And your fat-soluble vitamins, your vitamins A, your D, your vitamin E, all of these are going to start to be absorbed in this last part of the small intestine, okay? Most of the time, what people are experiencing when they're not feeling well is actually a malabsorption issue, okay? Here in North America, I mean, people like eat so much, right? Because everyone, you know, 70% obesity, so there's no problem with having enough food. But most people are malnourished. Most people don't feel good. I started working with a friend of mine who's working on one of my health and wellness and weight loss programs. And, you know, I talked to her yesterday. She goes, I can, and she's my age. She goes, I cannot believe how good I feel. I didn't know I had this kind of energy. She goes, I actually bounded up the steps to the on the stairway. She goes, my legs feel better already, my mind, my focus. And so I think that she, like many of us, was just malnourished, although she, quote, eats good. But if the food isn't getting in, if it's not absorbing correctly, you know, you're going to find yourself in a little bit of a stupor throughout the day. You should have all kinds of energy, good physical energy, good mental energy. If that's not happening, then you probably don't have enough vitamins, minerals, and nutrition in. So A, digestion, and B, making sure that you're, you know, taking, in my opinion, taking extra, you know, supplements, you know, along the way. Okay. Things like Crohn's, again, I'm not a medical doctor. Okay. I just want to tell you that over the years, I have seen people that were diagnosed with Crohn's. I found that the majority of those people actually had parasites. Okay. And, you know, so I don't know if that's diagnostic or not, but the test I had would show that. I knew from, you know, their symptoms. When you think about it, if all of a sudden there's a hole in your colon, what's going on? It didn't just break apart. Okay. So I would just urge you to get with a health professional, you know, like myself or someone who knows a lot about this, because a lot of these things, you know, you can be, I shouldn't even use the word heal. They can be better. You know, they can be made a lot, you know, more comfortable than they are. I mean, there's nothing worse than not having, you know, a strong digestive system. So let's talk about the large intestine. The large intestine is a beautiful organ. It is about 5.5 feet long. Put your hand down on your right hip, okay, if you got it down there. Then you bring that arm, that hand up about 6 inches. That's what's called your ascending colon. Then if you go across the middle, almost like a swag, that's your transverse colon. And then down the left hip is the descending colon, and that goes into the anus, and that's how the whole elimination process happens. That colon is supposed to be about 2.5 inches around, okay? It's not a plastic tube. It's an organ. This is where your absorption happens, the water happens, and this is where the waste is, you know, just finishing up. That colon can get as teeny tiny as like a pencil could almost get through it, all right? And this is a weak colon. That colon can get stretched to be this big around, 5 inches around, believe it or not. And this is also a weakness, but it comes into a compaction type of situation. It gets compacted. And we can hold between 25 pounds of debris, of garbage, of crap in our colon, you know, believe it or not. And when we have all this food in there, it kind of starts to layer on, especially if your person is having any white bread products, white, you know, pizza, pasta, all this stuff, it layers on and it layers on. And then the good food we eat, it literally can't get through. You start to see that it's almost like there's a thick rubbery coating that goes on there. If you ever had a colonic, and a colonic is when they literally, you know, it's like a spray washing of your inside from the bottom up, okay? It's almost like a hose. It's very professionally done, but it gets inserted into the, you know, to the anus. The water and warm water gets flooded through your body. Obviously, you work with a professional who's schooled and licensed in this, and then you watch through a window, okay? There's like a plastic plexiglass window, and you watch as all of your crap goes by. It's kind of like the Wizard of Oz when the witch goes by in the window and all the stuff's floating around. I mean, you know, there's all kinds of things. You can start to see worms and mucus and just stuff that's built up for years. I'm actually, there's someone in Rochester I just heard about that's doing some good work. I'm going to make an appointment, so I will let you know how my colon irrigation is the actual word, how that goes and what kind of debris, you know, can be gotten, will be gotten, you know, out of my body, you know, from there. So it's really the body's, you know, waste dump, and it's, you know, it's really the sewer dump, you know, that goes on in that part of the body. Our colon, we want to be able to move our bowels 2 to 3 times a day. That is ideal. Okay. Sometimes people think they're constipated if they don't go for 3 or 4 days. In the herbal world, not going for, you know, even half the day is considered to be, you know, constipation. Highly recommend cleansing. You know that, cleansing the bowel, cleansing the colon, getting that garbage out. So when you remove all that debris from the small intestine and from, you know, the large intestine, then you're going to find that the food absorbs and you certainly don't have as many cravings, but you also are lighter. Think about if you're carrying around an extra 10, 20 pounds and it's just literally garbage, right? It's, you know, your garbage came, they compacted it into some big cement bricks and you walked around with some garbage. How do you feel when you let that go? You feel lighter. You have a lot more physical energy and a lot more mental energy. Fiber is super important to keep that system moving as well. They have shown that when you have more than 35 grams of fiber per day, your chance of cancer just decreases like crazy. Why? Because this stuff isn't sitting in your body, and the fiber acts like a broom. It cleans it all out. So your fiber, whether that's in your breads, you know, I like to use you know, flax seeds and chia seeds, and, you know, of course, your fruits and your vegetables. Up here in the Northeast, you know, we're finally, you know, getting into having some, you know, some real food. So that is a big important factor. And then of course the water is important, you know, to flush all of that out as well. The foods that are high in refined sugars and high in, you know, fats and high in, you know, in dairy, those are going to be hard to digest. They're hard for most people to digest. And that's why I'm not a big proponent of milk. You know, really too much cheeses, especially the cheeses that we have in the U.S., because they're really going to start to clog, you know, that whole intestinal area. The last thing I want to talk about is some of the signs that you may have, you know, a lack of hydrochloric acid, or you may have a difficulty, you know, with enzymes or some of these. You may have, you know, some bloating. You may have belching after meals. You may have gas after meals. You may feel indigestion or constipation. You may have particular food allergies. And again, I really urge you to work with someone from a natural standpoint, a holistic doctor, holistic health coach, someone along those lines, because so many of your food allergies are really just digestion, and they're really just a leaky gut. They're not more than that. So it makes me so sad when I hear that, oh, people can't have. I had a lady years ago that thought she had a milk allergy. We worked together for a little bit. She didn't have a milk allergy anymore. I mean, she liked milk. It was better for her. So many times our allergies, our reactions are just a problem of breakdown, and it's a problem of the quality of food that you're eating, you know, as well too. Some other symptoms of low hydrochloric acid could be nausea after taking supplements, having an itchy bottom, which is also meaning rectum, which is also a big sign of parasites. Okay. You may also have some acne. And why? Because the food that's not digesting correctly, if it's got any leaky going on, then what happens is so picture the colon, okay, 2.5 inches around, you got all this food in there and it's not getting through, okay, stop, not moving. And what's going to happen, it's going to leak out into the rest of the body, okay, so it's not like a plastic tube. Your large intestine is not a plastic tube, it's an organ. And so then it leaks out into the rest of the body, then it's got to go to the liver gets stressed, and that's why we end up with face problems and related to our colon. Another thing is, and I've said this before, for some of you may have heard it before, if your feet smell, it's related to your colon. If you've got bad breath and it's not related to mouth, oral hygiene, or, you know, rotten tooth or something, it is related to what's going on in your colon. Do you have a lot of body odor? Related to what's going on in your colon. So a big colon cleanse is like one of the best ways that you can go. I recommend a 2-week colon cleanse. This is not a fast, okay? Colon cleansing is not a fast. Colon cleansing means you eat regular food. You know, you don't drink a lot of alcohol and you don't eat a lot of crap, but you're eating clean, you're eating green. But when you clear that stuff out, I'm telling you right now, you will be amazed at how energetic. You'll like find yourself that you didn't, as self, you didn't even think that you had. Some of the difficulties that come on our skin are also hives can be related to our digestive system. Also candida, we talked about yeast and candida. Very much related to how things are breaking down in our gut. And also we talked about parasites, you know, just a little bit too. So that's pretty much what I have, you know, for you today. If there's anything that I can help you with, you can always give me a call. My website is getwellnaturallynow.com. There's a lot of information on there. You know, I think that that's about it. Does anyone have any questions? It's nice to see you, Chad. Hey, Cindy, nice to see you. Hi, Bev. Thank you so much. I'd appreciate if you could, you know, write down something you learned today or something. Yeah, Cindy says, oh, dairy hurts her system. Yeah, you know why? Because cow's milk is for cow's baby. It's not for us. You know, but we're brought up that way, and it's the dairy industry. I give them a, you know, whatever, their marketing works. Like, milk does the body good, does it? I don't think it does. You know, there's a lot of more beautiful and easier ways to get you know, calcium into your body, and milk, in my opinion, does not do the body good at all. I think I talked about that when it came to bones. So have yourself a wonderful day. If I can help you in any way, do let me know. We'll be back again tomorrow. Let me tell you, I actually know what I'm talking about tomorrow. Tomorrow I'm going to be talking about lungs, and not just lungs, but how we're breathing, how breathing can help, and then also too some things in regards to asthma that's really not asthma that you may, you know, find, you know, quite interesting. So yeah, Cindy gave up dairy 3 years ago. Good for you. I know Casey doesn't eat a lot either. So thanks so much. Appreciate you very much. Have yourself a beautiful day. Bye now.